Recording. So, hello everybody. Welcome to the fourth online class of relativistic physics, also known as physics in the time of coronavirus. Does anybody have any questions from the previous class or about the homework? You can raise your hand if you have a question. By raise your hand, I mean use the raise hand button because I cannot see everybody's video at the same time. Okay, so I'll take it. If there are any questions, if you think of anything, you please interrupt me at any point and jump in, okay? Not a problem. Okay? All right, so let's see, where were we? We were talking about the Hamiltonian, right? So we have the Hamiltonian for the electromagnetic field, and what we found is that it takes this form. Okay, so what are these various terms? This is the vector potential, this is the scalar potential, and this quantity is the canonical momentum. Okay, so the canonical momentum, how is it related to the Lagrangian? It's related to the Lagrangian in the usual way. It's the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocity. Okay, so now let's check that we are able to obtain the equation of motion for a charged particle. All right, so let's find out what the equations of motion are for this Hamiltonian. So we can either work with the Hamiltonian or we can work with the Lagrangian. So let me write down the Lagrangian also. Lagrangian is minus mc squared okay, and just to mention these terms in the Hamiltonian, the first term is just the kinetic energy and second term is the potential energy. Okay, so now let's calculate the equations of motion from the Euler-Lagrange equations. So we only have one dynamical variable, which is the position and the momenta or the velocity of the particle, right? We are assuming that our electromagnetic field, it can change in space, but it's constant in time. Mm-hmm. So there is no momentum associated with either A or with phi. So what does the Euler-Lagrange equation tell us? It tells us that this equation is satisfied, right? So now we have to look find this term dl by dv. Okay, and what is it going to be? So dl by dv, right? So dl by dv is just the, this is dl by dv, right? This is the generalized momentum of the particle. So this is just capital P, which as we worked out previously is related to the mechanical momentum in this way. P, small p, is the mechanical momentum. Big P is the canonical momentum. Sunita, hi, can you hear me? Hello? Sunita is a very...
Hey.
Okay. Hi, Sunita, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear.
Is your internet connection any better
today? Yes, sir, I can hear.
Okay.
Hello.
Oh, yeah. So your internet connection today is working fine? Okay, I'll take that as a yes. Okay, there it's breaking up on your end. Okay, well, so whoever doesn't have a great internet connection, okay, with those people, I can always chat separately. After the class, we can have a separate session. All right. Sorry, Sunita, what to do? I can't understand what you just said. One second. Okay. All right. So the term that we need to calculate now is dl by dr. Okay. So like I said earlier, the vector potential and the scalar potential can be dependent on position, but not they are not dependent on time in this case. So what is dl by dr? dl by dr. Well, what is this? This is just the gradient of L, right? And if you look at this expression, keep in mind that R is the position, V is the velocity. So they are independent variables. So when I take dl by dr, the first term will give me zero. I only get the gradient of the second two terms. So I will get E by C, gradient of A dot B minus E gradient of phi. Okay. And so what is the Euler-Lagrange equation become in this case? D by dt of P, again P, capital P, not small p, is equal to E by C, gradient of A dot V minus E gradient of phi. Okay. Now, it's always good to pause and make sure that whatever you're doing looks reasonable. So on the left, what we have is the force on the particle. And on the right, if you look at the second term, we have negative of the gradient of the scalar potential, right? So if you remember, the electric field is equal to negative of the gradient of the scalar potential. So this term is just equal to E, capital E, vector electric field times the charge of the electron or the particle. So this is the force due to the electric field. And then this term is the force due to the magnetic field. But it does not yet look like the force in the form that you have seen this. So we have to do a little bit of algebra for that, okay? So what algebra is that? Well, there is a relationship, so let me first write it down, then I will explain that. A dot okay, so this is an identity. Now this looks a little bit complicated, and I'll come to how to prove this in a second. For the time being, let's take it as a given, okay? What are these various terms on the right-hand side? So let's look at this term, for example, A dot gradient of V. Now, component wise, what is this going to be? A dot gradient is what? AIDI, right? This is gradient, is a spatial gradient. And V is VJ, let's say, right? So the only free component corresponds to the V. All right, now again, keeping in mind that when we're taking the gradient, which is the derivative with respect to R, the velocity is a constant. We're keeping the velocity to be a constant because it's an independent variable, right? So this term will be zero and this term will be zero. Okay, now, so what are we left with? We are left with this term, V dot gradient of with A and V cross del cross A. This del cross A, what is this? This is our usual magnetic field, right? So what do we have now? dP by dt is equal to E by C V dot gradient A plus E by C V cross B and plus E times the electric field, right? We got all of that from here because we have the negative gradient of phi, so that gives us the electric field. And then we have used this identity to expand out this term and write it in terms of curl of A. So the curl of A term gives us the magnetic field, and this term over here. So we will deal with this term right now. So what is this canonical momentum? The canonical momentum is related to the mechanical momentum by this expression. Okay. So we are taking the time derivative of this object, right? So when we take the time derivative of this object, what do we get? We get dP dt, right? Plus E times E by C times dA dt, okay? Okay, now what is this dA dt? Keep in mind that this here, when you're taking this time derivative, this is not partial derivative, this is a total time derivative. So in the Euler-Lagrange equation, you have to remember, you have a partial derivative with respect to R on the left side, on the right side, a partial derivative with respect to V on the left side, but a total time derivative with respect to t on the left side. So that is where this d by dt is coming from, right? Now the total time derivative of function can be expanded in terms of the partial derivatives, right? So let's say that A is a function of time and position, okay? And I know I said that it's not time dependent and that will show up in a moment, but just to write down the expression, we, you know, in general, we'll say it is. So what is the, going to be the, if you expand it out using the chain rule, you have to take, right? This is the expression for the total derivative in terms of the partial derivative. Is this okay with everybody? Mm. Right? Are there any questions you please ask me? Any questions? No questions? Okay. All right. So let's put this back in here, right? And so what do we find? We find dp dt, capital P is d small p dt plus E by C, right? E by C times total time derivative with respect to A by T. Total time derivative becomes this expression. And as we said that d by dt, the partial derivative is zero, or sorry, let me keep the partial derivative non-zero, okay, for the time being. So we get d by E by C dA by dt plus, now if you look at this term, what is this term? The first term is dxi by dt. What is that? That is just the velocity, ith component of the velocity. Then, so this becomes this expression, right? And what is this? This is V dot gradient of A, right? And you remember this V dot gradient of A showed up earlier on the right hand side when we use the vector identity. So here we get E by C times V dot gradient of A. Okay. So this is the left hand side. And on the right hand side, we have this expression. So I'll just copy that and paste it here. And that's really nice. I can't do that with a blackboard, right? Okay. Okay, sorry, something. Okay, so now you can see that this term and this term cancels, right? And what are we left with? Dp by dt, which is this term here. I take this partial derivative over to the right hand side. I get E by C V cross B. Plus E times E, or let me for the time being write it as minus E gradient of phi and minus E by C dA by dt. Okay. So if you remember, the complete expression for the electromagnetic field is what? It's not just the gradient of phi. It also includes the time derivative, partial time derivative of A. Yeah? Right? So if you remember, where does this come from? You have F mu nu. This is the definition of the field strength tensor. And if you ask what is the component F0i, so 0i are the components of the first row, except for the F00. What is this going to give me? This gives me D0ai minus DiA0. Right? And this is equal to what? It's equal to EI by C, mm-hmm. Right? So this expression is minus gradient of phi, and this expression is d by dt of A. And there should be a minus sign. Okay. anyways, you can work it out all nicely when you look back at your notes, okay? So what do we have finally? We have this expression. And what is this expression? This is dp by dt is equal to E by C V cross B plus or E plus V cross B by C. Right? So we'll draw a big box around that. What is this? This is the Lorentz force law. So starting from the Lagrangian, we have shown that the particle behaves as expected under the influence of an electric and magnetic field. So let's go over this again. We start with the Lagrangian, which we derived in a previous class. And again, it helps to remember what the process of deriving the Lagrangian was. This is the Lagrangian, this is the part for the relativistic point particle, free particle. This is the part which comes from coupling the vector potential to the motion of the particle. And how do we couple it? We couple it in the simplest way that we can do. We take the scalar product, which is a Lorentz invariant of A and the tangent vector, right? So this gives us this expression, right? So again, just to remind you, the tangent vector is dx mu by d s, let's say, where s is the proper time, right? And this is basically nothing but the four velocity vector. So the four velocity vector has components. What are the components? Gamma C, comma gamma V. All right? Mm-hmm. And then the factor of gamma goes away when you look at the relationship between time and proper time. This factor of gamma will go away, and then you will be left with V dot the vector potential, which gives you this term, and you'll be left with C dotted with A0, which is this term, right? Anyway, so you have to go back and recall all of this. Then we use the Euler-Lagrange equation. The Euler-Lagrange equation gives us the definition of the canonical momentum. On the left hand side, it's just d of dp by dt. On the right hand side, we have to take the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the position. When we do that, what do we get? This term gives us zero. This term gives us a gradient with respect to r. That gives us these two terms. This term we now expand using a vector identity, which I will talk about now. That vector identity, two terms cancel out because velocity is independent of r. And then finally, you use this total derivative of A on the left-hand side, and again, there are some more cancellations. And at the end of the day, you're left with the Lorentz force law. Okay? So, is there any step here which is not clear? Of course. It is possible that none of this is clear.
Yeah, that's fine.
Huh? If anybody has that's any fine. Questions, you please ask me. Vaishnavi, any question? Vaishnavi, your video is very dark. Okay. And other people, their videos are not turned on. It would be nice if you would turn your videos on, because, well, it's a class. It would be nice to see people's faces. No question, Vaishnavi?
No, sir.
No? Okay.
No, sir.
Okay. So, so this gives us the Lorentz force law. Great. We are very happy with that. Okay. Now, what do we do with this? What's the next thing? The next thing is, well, let's try and look at some solutions of this Lorentz force law. All right. So, in other words, let's ask, right, what is the solution of this equation of motion, this differential equation, for various values of the electric and magnetic field? Okay. So let me work out one of these. But before I do, I promised you that I would tell you more about that vector identity. So let me do that now. So what is that vector identity? That vector identity is the following. Gradient of A dot B, right? And if you write it in component notion, what is that? D of I, AJ, BJ, right? It becomes, expanding using Leibniz rule, it becomes dIBJ times AJ. And dIAJ times BJ. Okay, this is just, we're just expanding the product. Now, the other side of this identity, you might not remember the expression, so let me write it down. It was, okay, it was A dot gradient of B plus B dot gradient of A plus A cross del cross B plus B cross del cross A. All right. Now let's look at these terms one by one. A dot del times B. So there is a little mismatch between the case of the, here I have used capital A and here I have used small a. It's all the same A, okay? So this term is this expression, right? AI dot gradient, that is AI DI times BJ, acting on BJ. Then this is the second term. So if you want to be fancy with colors and everything, we can do it like this. Then we have the remaining two terms, which are these cross product terms. So what about them? Well, here you have to use the epsilon tensor identities, okay? So it helps to recall that if you have two vectors A, B, their cross product can be written as this expression, right? I hope everybody knows this. Like I said, every night before you go to sleep, you should memorize your epsilon tensor identities so that they become a part of your bloodstream, right? So if I do this expression, then what do I have? I have A cross curl of B. What is this? This is A cross del cross B, right? So I want to write down the ith component of this expression. The ith component of this expression is going to be epsilon ijk, ak, sorry, aj, the jth component of this first vector, times the kth component of the second vector. That means del cross B, K, the kth component of del cross B. So now again, I have to insert one more epsilon to determine this del cross B. So del cross B, K, it's going to be epsilon K, right? That's the free index. And two other indices I need, M and N, right? So it's exactly the same expression as a cross product. Instead of a vector, here I have a vector, here I have an operator, but they both behave the same way. So instead of A, I will write D of J, D of M acting on B of N. Okay? So I insert this expression over here. And then finally, this quantity can be written as epsilon ijk, epsilon kmn, aj, dm, bn. Okay? This looks like a lot of gymnastics. Now, you have to do a little bit more algebra. For the purposes of the algebra, it's helpful to put two of the indices on top. Now, in this case, we're talking about purely spatial indices. So putting indices on top or bottom doesn't change anything in the expression, but it helps us do the math a little bit clearly. So now you can see K index is repeated right here. Mm-hmm. So there's a sum over K. And so you have to use the identity that when you take two epsilons and you contract over one index, you get delta mi delta nj minus delta mj delta ni. Okay? And this multiplied by aj dm bn. Okay? You can convince yourself that this expression matches this expression. All right. So for example, if you take m and n in this expression, in the second expression, let's say you take m and n to be 2 and 3. Okay. Then the only only value for which the epsilon can be non-zero is k is equal to 1. Right. And so that means here also, in the first epsilon also, the only value of k which will contribute to the sum is k is equal to 1. But that means that I and j can be what?
2 or
only
3.
Only 2 and 3, mm-hmm. Right? Or 3 and 2, right? They can be either one. So now I'm saying m and n are 2 and 3, right? And I and j, either they are 2 and 3 or they are 3 and 2, right? So now if you look at this delta expression over here, if m and n are 2 and 3 and I and j are 2 and 3, then what will I get? I will get 1, 2, 3, and here I will get 2, 3, 1. These are both positive permutations, I'll get plus 1. Mm-hmm. Which is the product of these two terms. But if I and j happen to be 3 and 2, then I'll get a negative permutation. So I get a negative sign, so I get this second term. Mm-hmm. Okay? So you substitute this expression in this identity. So this is the first term which comes from the A dot gradient of B, this B dot gradient of A, and then you have these two other terms, A cross del cross B plus B cross del cross A. So you multiply it all, you get some cancellations, and finally you're left with this expression, which you find is the same as D of J, A and B N and Q D. Okay? So I will ask you to prove this in the next homework assignment. So today is Tuesday. Next homework assignment will be due on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Next homework assignment will be due on Saturday. And the assignment problem is to prove this vector identity, which I've already shown you more or less, which is show that second again. that gradient of A dot B is equal to A dot gradient B plus B dot gradient A cross curl of B cross curl of A. Okay. So this is your homework for, this is the first homework problem. Okay. Any questions? Questions? Vaishnavi, are you still with us? I think she got disconnected. All right. No questions, no feedback, nothing. That means either everybody is understanding everything or nobody is understanding anything. So it's a delta function. Good. I like that solutions. All right. So now let's look at an example of solving this this equation of motion, which is motion in a constant uniform. Well, these are both the same thing, so it doesn't make any difference, electric field. All right. Okay. So what is this? Let's say that the electric field is constant and it points purely in the x direction. So this is the electric field. Okay. Then we can easily read off the equation of motion, right? Dp by dt, there is no vector potential, so this just becomes E times capital E. Very simple. And then you get px dot is equal to this and py dot is equal to zero. Okay, so the solution is easy. E times E of x times t, p of y is equal to some constant p naught. Okay. Now, what is the kinetic energy of this particle? Okay. So the total kinetic energy, we are going to use the relativistic expression, okay? Is pc square plus mc square whole square. All right. So what is this is equal to, we'll just write it like this, p square plus m square c square. So what is p square? P square is right, it's p naught square plus E square, EX square, T square. So this is not C square, this is just C. Square root M square, C square. Okay. Now all of this okay, so all of this can be written in the following form. P naught square C square, bringing the C square back into the picture. C4, this expression, plus C e of x t whole square. This expression, the first term under the square root, we'll refer to as E naught, that is the kinetic energy of the particle at time t is equal to zero. If it's at time t is equal to zero, and let me use a slightly different symbol for the kinetic energy so as not to confuse that with the electric field, I'll use this curly E. So the total kinetic energy is root of epsilon square plus C E E X T square. Okay. Now, right. So this total kinetic energy can be related to the velocity of the particle in the following way. So the kinetic energy is equal to gamma c square, and which can be written as the expression can be written as P C square over V, and where P is the relativistic momentum, so that's equal to gamma mv. So if you substitute this in here, you will get gamma mv divided by V, that will give you gamma mc square. Okay, so you can write down V is equal to PC square by E. Okay. Yeah, a lot of people have unstable connections, unfortunately. So now this is a vector equation. So this tells us that Vx is equal to Px C square by this. And what is Px? Px is the momentum in the x direction, which is given by this expression. This is equal to E times xt C square by epsilon. And on the, this is equal to dx by dt. So we are left with this expression, dx by dt is equal to E C square Ex by epsilon, which is a function of t times t. So we can write this as C square E Ex t over square root of epsilon naught square plus C E Ex t whole square. Okay. All right. So we can integrate this, and if we integrate this, you will find that x is equal to uh, I'll just give you the solution. Root of epsilon naught square plus CEX AT squared. And there'll be some constant X naught, but we can set that to zero. Similarly, we can write down the equation for the Y component. When you integrate that expression, you will find that I'll give you the solution and I will give you the your next homework problem will be to work on the solution yourself. Sin H inverse C E X A T by epsilon naught. Okay, these two expressions can be combined. So you can write y as a function of x or x as a function of y. And you get x is equal to epsilon naught cosh EEXY over P naught C. Okay. So your second homework problem is the following. Homework number two, which is starting from this expression. And save that. And this expression, right? So this is dx dt. And what is this P? P is of this form. So you take the expression for P, substitute it in this expression, and use this expression for the energy, and you do the integration to write down the solution. Is there somebody saying something in chat? Sir, can you please send these notes? Okay, I will send you these notes. Sure, why not? See, these are our notes. Can you see them? Can you take a screenshot? No? Okay, fine. I'll send you the notes.
Find the solution means the one that we just found. I mean, the one that you gave just now.
Exactly.
Okay,
now. We can do the same thing for motion in a constant magnetic field. We can do the same thing for constant electric and magnetic field. There are lots of nice problems like that. So, I will send you one more problem. I will write down a little more background and then I will send that to you. Okay. Otherwise, you will be a little lost. Okay, so we have come so far and we are all very happy. I hope I'm happy. I hope you're happy. Though happiness can be subjective. Okay, so what happened? All right, so I guess we've had a 50-minute class. That's quite a decent length. We've talked about the Lorentz force law derivation, right? From the Lagrangian Hamiltonian, we've talked about the one example of the solution of the equation of motion. There are some problems which I will send you. Equation of motion of a charge in a uniform electric and magnetic field. I'll send that to you with some background so that you can solve it. But keep in mind that up till now, almost all the homework problems I've given to you have been basically easy. Okay? They're all like plug and chug. Right? So you haven't really done any problem solving. So you'll be doing that now. Okay? All right. Are there any questions? Any questions? No? Okay. To complete the Lagrangian formalism, we should be able to write down not just the equation for a particle interacting with a constant electric or magnetic field, right? We should be able to write down the Lagrangian for the case when the electric and magnetic fields are not time independent, right? So apart from the Lorentz force law, which is the force acting on a point particle, we should also get Maxwell's equations, right? That would give you the complete expression for the dynamics of the system. You would have, there is a crow in the background in somebody's audio. So can you please turn that crow off? Okay, so in addition to the Lorentz force law, so this is, let's say, E1, we should also get Maxwell's equations. And so on. Something, and curl of B is equal to something. Right? So we can call this E2. And then the complete solution for a point particle moving in an arbitrary electromagnetic field will involve how many? 5 different differential equations, right? So at each time step, if you had to do this numerically, right? How would you do it? At each time step, what would you do? So curl of E would be proportional to minus dB dt, or is it plus dB dt? I can never remember, and this is minus dB dt, something like that, whatever, plus some j. So at each time step, what would you do? At each time step, you would calculate this quantity. You would calculate, so you would have 2 constraints. These are your constraints. Right? The electric and magnetic field always have to satisfy these constraints. If they are not satisfied at any given point in time, that means you have made a mistake in your computation. So this is the rho, this is the charge density. The charge density will be determined by where the point particles are, right? By the locations of the point particles. So if you want to write down the charge density as a function of time, what is it going to be? It's going to be summation of qi delta ri minus r so ri minus r and where is the t from? Right, so it will be ti minus t. What is this expression? This expression on the right is the charge density. It says the charge density at a certain point in time and at a certain point in space. What is the expression on the right? On the right, I'm assuming that my charges can all be treated as point charges. And each point charge has a charge Q of I, right? So how much does it contribute to my charge density? It contributes an amount Q of I, right? And it contributes at the point x and t only if the coordinates of this charge correspond to this x and t. Otherwise, it doesn't contribute, right? And then, of course, this is a charge density, so I will have to put some sort of volume factor over here. I'll take my space divided up into cells. So this is how I would calculate it. I would evolve the positions according to this equation. I would evolve the electric and magnetic fields according to this equation. And at each time step, I have to make sure that these constraints are preserved. So this would be electromagneto-hydrodynamics. Okay. This is how one solves problems in industrial applications or in research settings. Okay. So the question then is, how do we modify the Lagrangian so that we get Maxwell's equations also in addition to the Lorentz force law? So what we found is, this gives you the Lorentz force law. So if you want Maxwell's equations also, what we have to do is we have to add one more term to the action, which looks like this. So let me just tell you briefly what this term means. Well, F mu nu. If you remember, I had you do this problem in a homework, I think, once. And this turns out to be equal to E square minus B square. And what is this d4x? D4x is just the integral over time and over over space, over all time and all space. That's the action. But now there is a new ingredient that has come into the picture. So we have this field A mu, and this is equal to phi by C comma A. These are actually, so now we are saying these are dynamical fields, right? Why are they dynamical? Because now the action contains this expression, E square minus B square. E contains dA by dt. B contains curl of A, right? So the dynamics of, so because there are time dependent terms in this action, this four vector potential also picks up a momentum term, right? So since it has a momentum, that means it no longer is a constant, right? So with time, the electric and magnetic fields will also change. And now this, what is the new ingredient? The new ingredient is that now, instead of talking about the Hamiltonian or the Lagrangian of a point particle, so if you talk about the Lagrangian of a point particle, or if you talk about the action, what is the action? The action just says that I take L and integrate over dt. That's it, right? The Lagrangian is a function of position, and there is some trajectory that the particle follows. And I integrate this at each point, I find the Lagrangian, which is Lxt, and I integrate it over time, and that gives me the action, right? This is how I work with point particles. But now there is a difference here. What is the difference? The difference is that instead of a point particle, I actually have a field, right? So my Lagrangian now depends on something like E square minus B square. Okay, now what are E square and B square? E square and B square are functions of x and t, right? So you can't just talk about the electric field at a single point or the magnetic field at a single point, right? You have to talk about the electric and magnetic fields through all of space, right? At each point in space. So if you want to write down this action, you have to take this electric and magnetic fields, you have to integrate it over space. And then that you have to integrate that over time. Okay. So what you have is here you had a single degree of freedom, the position. Here you have an infinite number of degrees of freedom. Right? Because at each point in space-time, you have to talk about the electric and magnetic field. And you have to talk about this for all points of space-time. And there are an infinite number of points. So you get an infinite degree of freedom. Right? So here on the left, what we had was particle mechanics. Right? And here what we have is field mechanics. So instead of talking about a single point particle, we are not now talking about the dynamics of a field. Okay. So maybe we'll talk more about this in a later class. But when you do the variation, we did the variation for this guy. It was easy enough to do to find the Lagrangian, and from the Lagrangian to find the equation of motion. We can do the variation of this one also, but it's a little bit more involved. So maybe we will look at that next time. Okay, so we've already gone over 1 hour, so I will leave it here. Are there any questions? No? Okay, so shall we have the next class on Thursday? Any objections to the next class on Thursday? Today is 26th, Thursday is 28th. Is that fine with everybody?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, okay, great. And now,
sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
Sir, finally, how that equations came into hyperbolic, sir?
So that's your homework, na, Divya?
Okay, but I didn't understand from x is equal to 1 by e into c root of something. But after that, how it came to sine hyperbolic in course? Please give us some ideas. I didn't understand how to proceed.
Well, if you look at, you look at this expression, right? Here you have, in the second term, you have CE, this expression. Here in Y, you have this expression, right? So now, this expression for X can be written in this way. You can take epsilon naught outside the square root. You can write this as root of 1 plus this whole thing square over epsilon naught square. Right? What is this quantity? This quantity is this quantity squared. Yes?
Yes.
Is this enough of a hint or do you want me to tell you more?
Yes, sir. No.
Now
no,
you
sir.
Can do it. Right? Now you take the assignment. If I tell you any more, then I mean, really no point.
Yes. Yes, okay? Sir.
Anything else? Okay, so shall we have the next class on Thursday 28th? So next class will be Thursday 28th. Then the next class this week, we can have on today, but today's Tuesday, no? Then we can have it on Friday, I think. We'll talk about that on Thursday. Right, about the next class, but tentatively we can fix Friday as a date. Okay, so I will send you these homework problems and I want the solutions by Saturday. Okay, in the same way, but this time actually what I will do is I will like try to set up a page on Moodle on Iris or something where you can log in and upload your solutions, so you don't have to send me a separate file. Then I have to save each file separately, rename it, and becomes a little bit of a, maybe there's a better way to do it. Okay. So don't send me your homework solutions. I'll send you a link or something in where you can upload it. So I'll have everybody's file in one place at the same time. And I would like you to name your file with you know, your first name, then PH862, then assignment, and then the date the assignment is due. So Saturday, today is 26th. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 27, 28, 29, 30. So it's due on May 30th. So it will be first name, PH862, assignment, May 30th, 2020. Okay? All right, so shall we wrap it up then? Okay, all right. Nice seeing everybody. Oh, I wanted to ask everybody one question. How many of you have been doing Jhadu Poncha at home? One second, let me turn off this. Now. Now I can see everybody. So how many people are doing Jhadu Poncha at home? Manas, Rasmita, the rest of you, mommy, daddy? Huh? Shameless people. I have developed such a good physique from washing dishes and mopping my house and also cooking. This is a good time, right? This is a good time to work on your, to do some exercise. Don't waste this time. It's a very good time for many, many, many things. It's not a good time for other things, but you know. All right. Okay, I'll see you all on Thursday at 3.